Five. We're getting there. Maybe. Let's begin. Hi there, I am Drew Badger, the founder of EnglishAnyone.com, and welcome to another live video here on YouTube. Today we're going to talk about options, as I've got over here. Looks like live is working. If you are in the chat, do comment, let me know, make sure chat is working over here, but I think we should be good to go. What did I do with my eraser? All right. Well, I thought to do today's video because I came back home last night and I was talking. All right, looks like chat is working over there. Nice to see that. So I was talking with my older daughter Aria when I came back home last night, and she said, "Dad, I came home and I did my homework, and then I watched some, I don't know, like she did a like watched an art show or something like that." So she was saying that, and then I said, "How else can you say that?" And she said, "Oh, well, I watched the art show after I did my homework." And I said, "Very good." So sometimes I will just kind of practice with my kids like that because I really want to train them to have multiple things to say. So one of the big reasons why non-native English speakers get stuck in conversations is because they can't think of a specific thing they want to say. And that usually happens because they're thinking about something in their native language and they translate that in their head before they speak. They try to organize sentences and make sure that they can express something. But if they can't find the right word, then usually they get stuck. Now, what happens in the native mind and in your native language, this is probably the same thing. You have a particular thing, like an idea you want to express, but there really could be many different ways that you express that. So let's say, as my, like in the case of my daughter last night, so she's talking about like an order of doing something. So first she did this, so here's number one, and then she did number two. Now, a very simple way to say this differently would be just to reverse the order of these things. So I could say, first I did this, and then I did that. Or I could say, before doing this, I did that. Before doing this, I did that. So this is really just a very quick story, but it highlights a very important difference about the way natives learn versus how non-natives learn. The interesting thing is you don't need to be a native to learn English as a first language. So you don't need to be a native to do the things that natives do. There's nothing special about my blood or something like that that makes me a native speaker. The only difference between me, so someone who speaks fluently, and someone who does not is how we learn. So I could be living wherever, it doesn't matter what country I'm living in, I can still learn English and become fluent in English as a first language. All right, so before I go and answer questions, I just wanted to ask, just to help you do this, I thought it would be more interesting if I got some example sentences from you and just to give you some different ways of expressing yourself. I'll give one more example though. So yesterday I was also meeting a friend of mine for lunch, and while we were having lunch, I think he was taught, he basically told a story about how he had been talking with some guy, and the guy like forgot to contact him again. So let me just draw, I'll draw like a picture of him. So this is person A and then person B over here. So person A had contacted person B and said, "Hey, please, respond to me or get back to me when, when you have time or whatever." But person B did not respond back. And so, like, nothing happened for a long time until both of them were at like the same meeting together. And person B saw my friend and he looked a little bit kind of shy and sad and disappointed, a little bit maybe ashamed that he didn't respond to my friend. And so they talked a little bit, and I said, "Oh, I hope you, I hope." So the situation is this guy should have responded. He should have said something, but he did not. It's not a big deal. My friend didn't care so much. But this guy obviously felt a little bit nervous about that. He felt ashamed because he didn't respond as he should have. And so I said, I hope you... Now, what are different ways we could express this situation? So I'm basically saying, I hope you forgave him. So to forgive someone, it's okay that you did something. I'm sorry, you know, it doesn't matter. It's not a big deal. So there are different ways you can say that, but the idea is to forgive someone. Now, especially you're forgiving this person because maybe he can like help you in business or somehow something like that. Social anxiety attack. You know, this is not about like, you know, being worried about communicating in this situation. Although many English learners do get maybe, I guess, a social anxiety attack if you feel like you're too nervous to be able to express yourself. But in this case, I said, I hope you forgave him, but those are not the words that I used. So that's what I want to express. But a different way that I expressed this was, I hope you, and let me just erase this down here. So I hope you, and this is a native expression over here that he understood. So he and I are both native speakers and he understands a bit more of an interesting expression like this. So I hope you let him off the hook. I hope you let him off the hook. So I hope you let him off the hook. It's the same way of saying like, forgive him, but this is a more poetic, more interesting, more native, more natural way of saying, I hope you forgave the person. So to let someone off the hook, you can imagine like a fisherman. So here's my fishing pole, got my string down here and a little hook at the end of it, and the fish comes over. Oh my goodness, that's a bad looking fish. So here's the fish, and the fish is trying to catch the little worm that's on the hook, and so now, I got the fish on the hook. I have him on the hook. So the fish is on the hook if I have caught, or if I caught the fish. And so if I let the fish off the hook, it means, so I'm letting him off the hook, then I like pull the hook out and I let the fish go free. So in this case, like the situation was, this guy felt like he was on the hook. You know, so if you're on the hook for something, so this meaning of the word hook, it's the same idea of just like a fish hook. So you've got someone on the hook for doing something. So you've captured them, you're holding them, and they are responsible for doing something. So they are on the hook for doing something. So again, the opposite expression is to let someone off the hook. So if you want to say I have responsibility for something, another way of saying that is I'm on the hook for whatever. So I'm organizing a party with my friends. I'm on the hook for like organizing the event, doing something like that. So again, like to forgive someone is to let them off the hook for this situation. So my friend let him off the hook. So this guy felt like he was, I don't know, maybe he was ashamed or something, he had done something wrong. But instead of me saying, did you forgive him or I hope you forgave him, I said, I hope you let him off the hook. I hope you let him off the hook. Now, the point of this story, again, is when I'm speaking, I do this so quickly as a native speaker, and you probably do the same thing very quickly, too, when you're speaking your native language. But you have an idea you want to express. It's almost like you have a... I don't know, you can imagine like a bucket or something. So the bucket is really, it's like a metaphor for the idea you want to say, but you could put lots of different things into this bucket. So I could say, oh, I hope you forgave him. Or I could say, I hope you let him off the hook. Or I could say, I hope you didn't make him feel bad. Or I hope you didn't press, I'll put another expression up here, to press. Press the issue. So I hope you didn't press the issue. So to press something, press the issue, I'm continuing to push on something. Like my friend says to him, hey, why didn't you contact me? And he gets angry and he starts making him feel bad. That's pressing the issue, to press the issue. So the thing that we're talking about. So as you can see, there are different things, different options that we can put in this bucket. and all of them are correct. It just depends on maybe the slight nuance. I'm having a casual conversation with a friend of mine, and so I use a casual expression like this. But this is fine too. I hope you forgave him, or I hope you let him off the hook. Let him off the hook. All right, hopefully everybody is getting that. So what I'd like for you there out in YouTube watching land is just to give me a particular sentence or something you'd like to say, and I will give you some different responses that you can also learn to say in replace or in place of that thing. Or to replace that. But you'll notice often when I'm teaching, I will try to give a few different ways of saying something. And I do the same thing again with my own kids at home. So my 4-year-old daughter and my 8-year-old daughter, I'm teaching both of them the same way. All right, so let me just go back quickly through chat. But again, if you do have anything, any even just like particular vocabulary or a phrase or a sentence, just let me know something and I will give you a different way of saying it. And that will help you feel more confident and fluent in conversations because you will have different things to say and your mind will think of something. It's almost like having a gun. So you can think about what's a good way to do it. So a kind of gun, like a revolver. So a revolver, to revolve means to turn around. So a revolver. This probably won't be a very good picture, but let's just say I have, it's a kind of gun that looks like this. Okay, so that's my, hey, it looks like a pretty good gun. So this part over here, the revolving part, inside this you've got different bullets. And you can spin the revolver like that, and so we put this area here, this is called the chamber. So you have a bullet in the chamber, and you have many bullets that you could use. So I could say, I forgive. I could say, let someone off the hook. I could say something else. So these are different bullets in the chamber, and you should be thinking about learning language in the same way. So when you learn something, you're actually understanding what a situation is. So what kinds of things could we use in this situation? And there probably are an infinite way or infinite number of ways to express yourself. And that's the interesting thing, like at least one main difference or one real result in difference between learning English as a first language rather than learning here as a second language like people normally do. All right, so let me go back, see if there's any questions. But if you have, again, a particular sentence or phrase or anything that you'd like me to help you with, let me know. Star, hello. I'm from Myanmar. This is my first time live, and I recently joined your Fluency Blueprint. Glad to hear it. Let me know how it's going. Remember, the goal of the Native Fluency Blueprint is to help you improve the skills that you don't get from traditional lessons. So most lessons, these are English as a second language lessons. These are really trying to give you lots of vocabulary and grammar to memorize, and they usually teach you through your native language. So you're going to get some translations, and when you think about translations and grammar rules when you learn, you will think about translations and grammar rules when you speak. So remember this idea, how you learn is how you speak. So the whole point of the Native Fluency Blueprint is really to improve the skills that you didn't develop, like confidence or being able to use more natural vocabulary, other things like that. Could be your listening or your pronunciation. But whatever that is, if you improve that weaker skill rather than learning more words or grammar, you're going to become a fluent, a more fluent, more confident speaker much faster. All right, so welcome to the program, but that's what you should be using it for. All right. let's see if we have any else. Nice to see you. Hello and hi from everyone. All right. I think I answered that one. Let's see. So, hey, Drew, nice seeing you again. Hope you are well. Our favorite teacher. Well, it's my pleasure. Yeah, I'm doing well. Feeling good today. Tarek says, first comment, but watching your videos for, you would say for, a while, watching your videos for a while. But that's another thing. So here, I'll give my first example of this. So that's actually some incorrect grammar, but that's fine for learning. That's how we learn. It just means like nobody taught you the right way to use that from the beginning. So if you say like, I have been watching you from a long time. Just as an example. So the idea is like you started before and now you are continuing to do something. So it seems logical that you could say this. So maybe in your native language, you use this like Japanese, it would work similarly to this. Like you could say like daibumai kara, like from a long time. But in English, where the idea of this, we're kind of talking about like this, if you want to talk about a long period of time, we would just say for. So I have been watching you for a long time. And the slight difference in meaning is not like that we started here, we're talking about this, like the duration. So I have been watching you for a long time. But you could, if you want to talk about the specific starting date, like, and you want to use the word from, you could say like, I started watching you from last week. So like a specific period of time, or I have been watching you from, I don't know, like since I was in college or something. So from last week or from 2 years ago, something like that. So you could talk about the period of time here. But notice the slight difference in the situation. So one situation is this, talking about when we're starting, and the other situation is talking about the duration of the time period. So I have been watching you for a long time, is talking about this, or I have been watching you from last week or since. You can use both of those. So here we have three different examples of exactly what I'm talking about. So you don't have to think about what is the one correct way of saying something. So instead of translating it, you're thinking about it like a native. What do I mean? Am I talking about when I started or how long I've been doing it? They mean basically the same thing. Like, because if you start here, we know how long it is. And if we know how long it is, we know you started here. But if you just want to talk about one or the other, these are different ways to talk about the same situation. All right? Isn't this interesting? Now, again, the reason I'm talking about these is because you will probably feel more comfortable saying one thing rather than something else. And that's why, or really another reason why you should be learning English as a first language and getting all these different examples of how to say something. So it helps you understand the situation better, and it gives you something more comfortable to say, and it makes sure that if other people, like another native might say for, or another native might say from, or since, you will be prepared for those other things in your conversations. All right, so lots of good reasons to do this. All right, so I will find examples even if I don't get any. All right, let's see here. Let's see. So he's good than our teachers in university. All right, now you would say he's better, Angel or Angel. I don't know how you pronounce it, but you would say he's better. So if I'm good, good is it just kind of talking about one thing by itself. But if you're comparing me with someone else, then you've got better. All right, so here's one teacher, here's another one. This teacher is better than this one over here. So if you're just talking about the person by themselves, like here is, here is a circle. This circle is good, as an example. I don't know what a good circle is, but it's just a simple thing to draw. This is a good circle. I'm talking about one thing by itself. But if I'm comparing these two things, well, this circle is good, but let's say, this circle is better. So when we have two things that we compare, now we're talking about better. This thing is good, but this thing is better. All right? So if you want to talk about one teacher being good and another teacher being better, that's how you say it. All right, this guy was on the hook. Is it correct? Yes, exactly, Sam. All right, hi there. Here in South Korea, Sisa, nice to see you there. English is difficult. Ah, that's interesting. Why do you think English is difficult? Now, a lot of people do think that, and I don't really disagree, but it's more about how you learn the language. I'll give you a very quick example that's not from English, and this actually, if you are a member of Fluent for Life, you will actually see this happen. I forget what lesson set it's in, but I was walking downtown here in Nagasaki, actually very close to where I'm recording this video right now, and I saw two They looked like about, I don't know, maybe college age kids, and they were on some BMX bikes. So these are stunt bikes. So this is the kind of bike, like a bicycle, where you can spin the front tire around. So the front of the bike, I'm not gonna draw this very well, but so you have like the front wheel up here and then the back wheel like this, and you can spin the front wheel around. And so they were doing some tricks, and I looked at them, and this one trick they were doing, they kind of pulled the bike up, spin the front wheel around, and then put the bike back down. So a very quick motion about how to do that. And so I was watching them and I thought, wow, they make that look easy. I wonder if I could learn how to do that. And so I had my friend with me and I said, hey, record this. And I just walked up to the guys. So these are two Japanese guys, maybe college kids. And I said, could you teach me how to do that? And this was, I don't know, 10 years ago, or it probably wasn't that long, but I don't remember. I don't remember when exactly it was. But anyway, my friend was recording it, and now we have that video in Fluent for Life as part of a lesson. I think it's in the education and learning lesson set. But you can actually watch this happen. You can watch me learn this trick, and it shows you something very important about how learning works. Now, part of the way they were teaching me, I was at first just trying to watch them and then try to see if I could do it too. But I kept falling over. I couldn't do the trick properly. So I had to hold on to the bike, and part of what you do is like you're holding on to the handlebars here, and you pick up the bike and flip the bike around, but you're not holding the handlebars, so you can fall over pretty easily. And I tried to do that, and I was watching them and trying to watch them very carefully, and I still couldn't do it. And then I asked one of the guys, like, what am I missing? What is like the wrong thing here? And he kind of looked at what I was doing. And I wasn't holding the bike with my legs. I just had my feet down on the pedals, but that's why I would, like, the bike would easily tip over. But if I hold the bike with my legs, I was able to do it. So it was really just that one thing that made the difference between doing it and not doing it. And so this is an example of when you teach someone how to do something, if you leave any kind of questions in their mind about it, it's just going to be more difficult for them to try to figure it out. And so when I'm like trying to teach you these things, or when you learn things, just even in your regular lessons with teachers, maybe you have regular English classes, if you have any doubts or any questions about something and the teacher doesn't answer that for you, then you will not feel confident using something in your actual conversations. So it's the confidence that lets you speak. If you don't feel confident, you don't really understand something, it's like, I didn't really understand how to do this. But once I knew, okay, you have to hold the frame of the bike with your legs so the bike doesn't tip over, and then it gets much easier. And I did the trick. And so you can actually see me do this in the video. So when people say, like, is this a difficult trick to do? I would say depends on how you learn it. So I learned it at first. It took me a while, but they didn't really know how to teach it to me. It was just me watching them and telling me about that specific thing later. But if I had to teach that trick to someone now, I could probably do it pretty quickly. So yes, English can be difficult to learn, but it's usually because people are learning English as a second language rather than learning it as a first language, and that's why it makes it much more difficult for them. So a teacher typically in an English class will just write some stuff on the board, kind of like what I'm doing now, but you won't be able to understand it. They will say, like, here's a grammar point and use this word plus this word and then this word over here, and then we'll give you a translation of what that is. And because you learn this way, you think about translations when you speak. All right, so that's the main issue for that. So English is not actually difficult to learn, and it's not actually easy to learn. It just depends on how you learn. So if you learn it as a second language, then you're going to struggle. But if you learn it as a first language, and you really have someone to make it easy to understand, then you will get fluent very quickly. All right, let's see if we have, let's see here. All right. Hello, I'm watching from, let's see, Reynosa, Mexico. Greetings to everybody. Thank you, teacher. It's my pleasure. Well, hello, everyone. Tarek says, I need advice as a teacher in regular way in Arabian country. You have a question? Let's see. Thanks for correcting my sentence. Yeah, if you have a question specifically about how to teach or you're curious about that, let me know. Anonymous says, hi, nice to see you there. Psychotic teacher is back. Drew, how have you been? I'm doing well. Let's see. Frederick says, how can I say, does what I just said make sense? You can just say, does that make sense? So that's a good example of some different ways we can say that. You will hear me use that a lot. I use that in my writing also. It's a very conversational way of expressing that. So does that, blue is running low, does that make sense? Now you can say, I think your example was, does what I just said make sense? Now you can say that, it's a little bit longer. It's easier just to say, does that make sense? So if you're already speaking and you just add this on the end, these four words, it's much easier, just very clear and simple, easy to remember. Does that make sense? So what you said was correct also. And if you can say that fluently, then that's great. But here's just another way of saying that. Now, the only thing about does that make sense, like it can seem a little condescending. So condescending means like you're kind of talking down to somebody, like, does that make sense? Like, you guys are stupid out, you know, like, hopefully you understand what this means. All right, so that there's that meaning, you could have that meaning, but you don't, it, you know, it doesn't need to be like that. This is why your tone of voice and your, like, the way you're looking, like, yeah, does that make sense? Does that make sense? You can see my, I'm being like a positive, caring teacher now, like, does that make sense? Dummy, you know, like, does that make sense? So it depends on how you say it, but that's another way to say it. You can also say, is that clear? So that's another way of saying, do you understand? Is that clear? All right. So these are just two different ways of saying that, but again, there are many. Does that make sense? Is that clear? Do you understand? Or am I being clear? That's another slightly different way. So is that clear or am I being clear? So often if you are trying to take responsibility for the speech, like you don't want to blame the other person and say like, do you misunderstand me? I'm just saying, am I being clear? So hopefully I am being clear. And I would probably say that, like if I'm being a bit more polite in a business meeting, that kind of thing. Am I being clear? Does that make sense? All right. Miro says, is there any better expressions to thank someone rather than I'm grateful and thank you? Oh, sure. But there's nothing wrong with saying that. You might find YouTube videos, it's like, don't say thank you. Like, that's just dumb advice. Of course you should say thank you. I say thank you all the time. Natives use thank you. You can say, again, you use the examples of thank you and I'm grateful, but you can also just say, I appreciate that. Or I really appreciate that, or I very much appreciate that. How can I repay you? So how can I repay you? Or how can I thank you is another way. So if someone does something really great, like they give you, I don't know, a free car or something like that. Oh my goodness, that was an amazing thing someone did for you. How can I repay you? How can I ever repay you? And this is part of usually humans. If we get something from someone, we want to respond or to reciprocate, to respond by giving something back to that person. So we feel a bit on the hook if we receive a gift for someone or from someone. It's not like our birthday or whatever. So usually we give gifts to other people on their birthday, and we get gifts on our own birthday, and in that sense, we're kind of repaying the other person. But how can I repay you is a great way to say that. There are many. You can Google something like that to just get more examples of appreciation, but these are different ways you could say that. Good question. But don't feel bad about using thank you and I'm grateful. There's nothing wrong with that. Let's see. Frederick says, how can I say? Oh, okay, we got that one already. All right, Lang says, your voice is so clear and it's very easy for me to listen. And even your body language, I can understand almost what you're saying. Thank you and hello from Vietnam. Well, it's my pleasure. Yes, I am intentionally speaking more clearly and just trying to be very calm and easy to listen to. That way you can hear my words. So this is really the first step for trying to learn English as a first language. So what I'm doing, I'm giving you some native vocabulary, but you really need to continue going and get more examples of this. So that's the kind of thing we do in Fluent for Life, where people can hear me, but they also hear lots of different native speakers saying things as they would normally say them. So I want to make sure you understand what I'm saying, and this is the same way often parents are teaching young kids in that same way. So they will make something clear. A child will say, what word was that? Or what did that person say? And the parent will make it clear. And then the child will be able to hear lots of different examples. All right. Tsubasa says, good morning, Drew-san. Ohayou gozaimasu. Nice to hear from you, Tsubasa. Let's see, an XDL with a weird-looking blue person. That's interesting. The emojis are just so different from when I was a little kid. Thanks for the efforts. Hello from Brazil, says Sandra. How can I make my students love the class, says Tarek. You make them actually make them learn. So when people enjoy something, people like learning. They like learning new information and they like being able, especially language learners, they like being able to impress other people with their language ability. So if you make the language easy to understand, then they will like the language and they will like the lessons. So that's what I do. Like people enjoy my lesson, they continue to watch my lessons because they actually improve with them. So if I'm just like teaching boring lessons, and again, like I'm trying to like speak in this way, it might like seem a little bit boring. I'm not being like really expressive or talking too quickly. I'm supposed to be clear and easy to understand. But that's really the number one reason why people don't like going to language learning classes. And that's anywhere. It's not like in, you know, some Arabic speaking, you know, classrooms or something like that. It's a problem everywhere. But that's why I teach English as a first language. All right, I could use a do you copy me? Do you copy me is like, it's a slightly, if I'm in a board meeting, so if I'm in a meeting for business, I probably would not use do you copy me. It's more of a casual thing. That's from the military, so army guys will use that, like copy, like I'm listening, like if I'm working construction and my boss says something to me like copy, like I repeat like yes, I understood that. Or he might say like do you copy, but I wouldn't say that like if I'm talking to people in a business setting or an academic setting, like do you guys copy what I'm saying? No, I wouldn't use that. So it's a more casual kind of industry specific way of doing that. But you can certainly respond to that in a casual way. So if someone says, hey, Drew, I would like you to do this, I can say, copy that. I understand. But again, it's much more casual and conversational. I am a shutter, says George. Am I a shutter? What does that mean? Is that a question for me? Does it make sense? Does it make sense is correct too, Drew? Yes, it is. All right, let's see. Sevket, blue is running low. Can I use if fuel is running low? Yeah, blue. So that's, again, like very, very good. You were listening. You caught that example. So you will hear me use things like that. And this is why people, like if you watch my videos a couple of times, you will notice more expressions. But you caught it the first time. Very good. So I was writing with that and I said, oh, no, blue is running low. Or it's like kind of getting low. You can say that as well. So fuel, battery power, anything where it reduces over time. So you could even have like the amount of something. If I'm working in a kitchen, eggs are running low, or milk is running low, or we are getting low or running low on a particular thing. So we're running low on milk. We need to get some milk. Yo, you. So if you don't feel the aha moment, it means I'm not learning correctly. Well, all right, I'll give another example of this. Like the aha moment, it really just means, do you understand the information or not? So when you're learning something, even learning as a first language, the lesson itself is not just one example of something. So one example is just one example. And if you understand something, like if I hold up this and I just say, ke. So I'm trying to teach you a word and I just show you one thing and I say ke. You don't really know 100% what I'm talking about. Am I talking about the color or the shape or whatever this thing is? Like, do I mean marker? What do I mean by that? It's not really clear. So I might give, you know, the first example of something, ke. So I'm trying to teach you a word. Here's a new word in an alien language, ke, ke. And so I show you this, and you don't really know. You can guess a few different things about that. Maybe I mean black, maybe marker, maybe I mean like a writing tool. So a writing tool, there are lots of different things I could mean by that, all right? So one lesson is not really going to give you the aha moment, even something as basic as like a physical object like this. So I could show you a cat or a dog or even something like that, and just one example is probably not enough to give you the aha moment. And that's why you should be getting lots of different examples. So if the first one I show you is K, and then I also show you K, and then I show you K over here, you can actually feel it in your mind where you're like, ah, we like your ability to understand. It's like you have a meter from 0 to 100. So when I show you the first object, it's like maybe I got 50% understanding from that. And I show you another example, and wow, now the understanding goes up to like 90%. So I'm pretty sure, like, because we're showing two different things that are similar. So here's a black one, and here's a blue one over here. Wow, I must be pretty sure that he means marker. And I give you yet another example, and now you're at, like, you know, 99 or 100%. And that's where the aha moment comes from. So you're like, it's like a feeling that goes up. Does that make sense? Francie is so bored. Oh no. Yes. If you are not enjoying the program, feel free to leave. So here we go again. Like, that's what we mean by the aha moment, and it's important to not quit. So if you when I'm trying to teach something, if I stop here, then I'm not really a good teacher because you don't understand the lesson. So I have to get more and more examples to you. I have to continue teaching until you get to that point where you really feel like you've got it. That's where the aha moment comes from. Now, the interesting thing here is that, like, the order of them doesn't really matter. So if let's say I show a red marker first and then a blue marker and then a black marker, it's basically the same process. So it's not any one example by itself, it's the network you get from all of these examples together. Does that make sense? And this is why this is another, it's the same idea I'm talking about in this video about having options. So if you have something you want to say, here's just a general, like here's a situation I want to express, there are different ways of expressing that. So I could say it like this, I could say it like that, and so all these things are working together. But the aha moment comes, as you understand, usually by building a network of different things. That's why you need multiple examples. So in Frederick, if you're playing Frederick, you can click on the link in the description below this video to get that. But if you have Frederick, you will notice there are multiple examples that help you understand what a word means. All right? So Jose, like the revolver analogy. Yeah, so it's the same idea with that. Like, you notice it's also, it's similar to having just different options. for when you're communicating. But I also need different options as a teacher to make sure you understand a situation. So in this one, the situation is just, I'm trying to teach you the word marker in an alien language, and that word is K. But how do I do that without translating? Because if I teach you with a translation, then you will think about the translation when you speak. But if I give you enough examples and I give you that aha moment, you're like, ah, now I got it. And you figured out what ke means by yourself. And that makes it much more memorable and you can actually use it in a conversation. You understand it well, you feel confident about it, and the fluency is just automatic. All right. So that was kind of a long explanation. But it's important that people understand how this works. So when people think about a lesson, the actual lesson is really a series of things. It's a group of things that helps you build that network of understanding in your mind. I'm out of fuel at work as well. How to make, fast thinking first language to second. Yeah, see, learn with Jax. So you don't really want to be, the goal is not trying to like think from one language into another, it's just to understand the target language like a native. So that's why you learn English as a first language, or in my case, I learned Japanese as a first language. So I'm not a native Japanese speaker, I wasn't like born in Japan, but I can learn in the same way that natives do. So I'm learning Japanese as a first language. And so I'm not trying to like translate quickly from one language to the other, but because I learned Japanese as a first language, I could have a situation and I could express that like I could say it in English, like black marker, or I could say it in Japanese, like kudoi maka. And I'm not really translating from one to the other, I'm just going from the situation to both very, very quickly because I think in both languages. So I'm not trying to translate. The point is to be able to understand it in the native language as a native speaker. Let's see, XDL. So why are the mountains the funniest place to travel? Because they are hilarious. I see. Very good. A nice pun here. We need a pun in every video, I think. Vlog says, I love you. Oh my goodness. Wow. A lot of love in the chat. That's what I like to see. Psychotic American again. Isn't it do what I say make sense? Do what I say make sense? No. Well, these are kind of two different things here. If I say do what I say, that thing by itself, it's like I'm telling you to do something. Do what I say. If I say clean your room, do what I tell you to do. Do what I say. But if I'm talking about does this make sense? So this is like the idea. So does this make sense? That's why we have, does what I'm saying make sense? So that's why we would use does, all right? So like if you ever are curious about like, do we use do or does, you're trying to think about the grammar this way, make this thing as simple as possible, like it, all right? So does it make sense? Does it make sense? So the most basic, simplest, shortest thing I can say is, does it make sense? Does it make sense? Then I can make that a little longer. Does this make sense? I can make it longer again. Does what I'm saying make sense? Does what I'm saying make sense? But the grammar works because this thing, like this is all like just one thing like that. It's just different ways of saying that. Okay. So does is correct in that sentence. Tarek says, I'm trying to imitate your voice so I can speak. Well, that's fine. Yeah, you can pay attention to my voice. Also, I recommend listening to lots of different people. You could even listen to other teachers. Remember, like, especially if you're trying to, if you want to become fluent, listen to more, like pick one teacher or maybe two teachers, like someone who's speaking with a slower, clearer voice like me. But then find lots of native examples to listen to, because that's what's going to get you fluent and prepare you to hear native speakers in real life. Let's see. All right, got lots of good questions over here. All right, Amiro says, yep, I can fully and easily understand you, and I also can understand, like, academic English, but when it comes to movies, for example, when they use much slang, I don't get them at all. Yeah, so again, it's a different way. Remember, you have a situation, just like I was talking with my friend, I can say, did you forgive him, or did you let him off the hook? So I'm using an idiom there just to make it, you know, casual and fun in the situation, and it just sounds, it's again, it's just a way of speaking. It becomes like an art, you know, rather than just communicating something. We want to have fun. We want to be expressive. That's why people, you know, they write and they use, you know, special words or other things like that just to explain things a little bit more, I don't know, poetically or just in a more interesting way. Regan says, I'm always confused by two past terms of the proposition. What is it? For example, the scientists were tested those participants. The scientists were testing those. I see. So you're talking about the past tense. For example, the scientists were, and this is another reason to get naturally varied review. So what we're talking about here, these are examples of naturally varied review. That's what builds the network of understanding in your mind. So for example, the scientists were tested. Yeah, you would just say, like, the most basic thing is the scientists tested something, or you can talk about a period of time like the scientists were testing. That's it. The scientists were testing. Neil says, sorry, I'm late. It's okay. We didn't have a plan for anything. You didn't have to meet me at a certain time, so I let you off the hook. All right, Cooper says, is debating a good way to learn English? Does public speaking need training? Some guys can do debating for hours on end eloquently and eruditely. How do they attain that astonishing skill? Well, fluency and being able to debate well, debating is a very specific skill, as you're mentioning, and you don't need to be able to debate well to be fluent. Again, fluency just means how well you use vocabulary. Can you express yourself without thinking and hesitating and translating, or do you need to do those things to express yourself? So debating or whatever, like, those are kind of higher level skills once you're already a good speaker. But you can certainly learn particular phrases, like we have lesson sets about debating and having, you know, arguments and that kind of thing in Fluent for Life. So if you can, if you're interested in doing that, you can look for examples of debating. But it's not like a necessary thing to become fluent. I'm Iraqi, and I was a translator with the coalition forces, and I struggled with the Scottish Army to understand them. Yeah. So if you're not used to somebody's accent, then of course it's going to be like more difficult for you. Bruce Yang, thank you. You're the greatest teacher I have met. Wow, Will. The greatest teacher. Well, thank you very much. All right, let's see. Predator Fission. That's an interesting name. I understand everything except actors and movies and songs. Very frustrating. Again, the reason we do that, let me just, since a couple of people are mentioning this now, and some people, I think some members of Fluent for Life are here. They will come enjoy these videos too. But the basic idea, what we do in Fluent for Life, is that we have the learner, so you, if you can understand me, so I'm speaking at a lower level of native English. And by lower, it just means slower, easier to understand, I'm more clear, and I'm using kind of more basic vocabulary, so not a lot of the things you would find in movies. So if you imagine that I'm at this level down here, people in movies and things like that, they're communicating at this level up here. Faster speed, they're blurring their speech, so they maybe mumble, they don't speak so clearly, and a lot of this is the vocabulary is just different. So you notice this language and this language, so they're both English, but they're really two different kinds of English. And this is why most people who only learn this, if you only watch YouTube videos about people teaching the language or whatever, and then you try to jump directly up here, it's going to be more difficult for you. So what we do in Fluent for Life is we want to teach you this. We want to prepare you for this, but you have to do it in steps. So So it's much more comfortable and easy as you get up to this level, and that's how you become a fluent speaker. That's how you can understand movies and TV shows and things like that, because we're teaching you the real vocabulary that they use, but we're also making it easier and giving you steps that get you used to that. So you have to be prepared for that. You're going to listen to other native speakers. You're going to hear lots of people using that same vocabulary that you hear. But at first, it's clearer and easier to understand. So the same thing with learning grammar or pronunciation, everything else. You learn in these steps, and that's how you get fluent. So this is what we do in Fluent for Life. If you are not, again, I'm running low on my blue over here. I'll just write the name. So even if you don't speak, if you would like to understand movies more easily, this is how you do it. You begin by just actually getting the vocabulary, hearing things in a clear way, and then make it a little bit faster, a little bit more difficult to understand. Then finally, you can watch movies and, oh, like, now I understand what people are saying. It's pretty simple. All right. So if you'd like to learn more about that, you can click on the link in the description below this video to learn more. All right, let's keep going, see if we have more questions here. Hopefully this makes sense, though, just because enough people are asking me about this. Remember that the language of lessons is going to be different from the language of the real world, especially things in movies and TV shows. let's see. Okay, I think I answered that question already. Let's see. Camo from Thailand, please speak slowly. More slowly than I'm speaking already. Hi, good morning. Let's see. How long did it take you to speak Japanese? Nils asks. Again, you become fluent in individual words and phrases. I'll tell you an interesting story. Would you like to hear a story about that? I'll go through and the things that I'm talking about when I first understood that I need to learn Japanese as a first language rather than learn it through English. And then I started doing that. Everything changed in my life for how I was doing it. But it's important to remember that you get fluent in individual words and phrases. So there's a lot of Japanese I don't know. Like I couldn't, I don't know, talk about advanced, I don't know, politics and government, I don't know, contracts or, you know, like a lot of stuff like that because I just don't know the vocabulary. I could learn it if I was in that situation and I needed to learn that for, you know, for work or something. So it's not about like how long it takes you to get fluent, because you get fluent word by word or phrase by phrase or grammar point by grammar point as you learn those things. So in an individual word or phrase, you could get fluent very quickly. I'll just tell you a very quick story. I thought about writing this and telling it to people. I'll just tell you guys here as well, since I share a lot of these stories with people on who follow me on email. So I was, this is, I think, like almost like 2 years I had been living in Japan. And so for the first year I was living in Japan, I really struggled to speak because I was studying a lot, but I wasn't actually learning anything like a native speaker. So I wasn't learning Japanese as a first language. But when I started doing that, then suddenly I was learning things and understanding things. And one example came when I was looking for an apartment. And I was sitting, it was me and a landlord and someone who was helping me from the government, just like helping me translate stuff, because I still didn't like feel confident speaking about that situation. So I didn't know how to like negotiate a rental agreement. So my Japanese was getting better and I was becoming fluent in everyday things like going to the grocery store or talking like that. But I needed some help with that. So I'm sitting there and it was a little bit hard for me to follow what was happening in the conversation. So the landlord is talking with, So this is me over here. And then this is the landlord, and this is my other friend over here, who is doing the translating. And so they are talking back and forth to each other. She is asking, I'll put some hair on her like that. So she is asking this guy, how much is the rent? How much is the rent? And he said basically like, I think he said like 65, I don't know, something like that. So it's almost like $600 a month or something like that. But he said very quickly, he was like, "Dokumango san." So that's Dokuman Gosen, like 6,500 or 65,000 yen. And so I heard that, and something like snapped in my mind. It was almost just like, I didn't think about it at all. I didn't hesitate. I just said very quickly, I was like, Yoma nanasen wa do? I just like very, very confidently, it just like came out. So I said like, how about like 4,700. No way, 47,000. This is what I hate about Japanese money. There's like too many zeros on stuff. So in America, if we want to think about the difference between American currency and Japanese, I'm like moving the decimal point back. And right now, actually, the currency is like, it's pretty weak. It's like 100 and I think almost 150 yen to the dollar right now. But anyway, so like they were talking and she told me, yes, like the price is like this much. And I just like snapped right there. I just said, Yoman nanasen wa do? And just like said it like clearly and perfectly. And I just said it directly to this guy. So I wasn't talking to her in English. I just spoke to him. It just naturally like came out in Japanese. So here I am. It's like I'm actually like now I'm kind of negotiating like that. And he looked at me and he was so surprised that like I spoke to him like that. And I was just like, Yoma nanasen wa do? And just like very like, so I was like, how, it basically I said, how about this much? And he said, okay. And so he told me, he's like, daijoubu yo. Like he said like, okay. And I think maybe like part of that was me just being confident, but also showing him like, hey, I'm learning the language, I'm speaking, I'm not like a bad guy or whatever. But all those things came together. And this is a particular example of like, of me learning Japanese as a first language and how that, like, it's just one example, but I thought I would share that because I was thinking about that today. I don't know why, but thinking about like specific ways that fluency has helped my life. And this was one example of that. And so I just thought it was really interesting. So I would have been paying this much, but now I'm paying this much for rent instead. All right. So that I'm like, that's a specific money that I saved because I could speak. All right. And I only said like one sentence. It was just like, Yoma nanasen wa do? Like, how about this? Like, Yoma nanasen wa do desu ka? And he was just, I just remember saying that to him. And again, like this is a perfect example of that. So I'm still responding to Nils' question about how long it took me to get fluent. I'm still learning lots of new things all the time in Japanese. So learning Japanese as a first language. But as I began doing this, I noticed like lots of little things start changing about how I'm speaking. Even if I didn't practice saying this number. It's not like I learned it in a textbook or something, but it's because I had started understanding the language like a native. Now Nils said I'm smart, but yeah, this is not like, it wasn't me. I wasn't thinking about that. I just like threw the number out. I was just like, that number like felt good to me. And I, you know, when you might as well give it a try. But like, so it wasn't me like planning that or trying to be particularly smart or sneaky or anything. I just said like, how about this? You know, and the interesting thing is when I said that to him, I became like a real person to this guy. He didn't think about it like that, but like when you're speaking to someone, you've probably seen this in movies before, like when someone is speaking a different language and then suddenly they speak your language. There's a movie called The 13th Warrior, if you have not seen that movie, but there's a really interesting scene at the beginning of that. There's a guy who's traveling with these Vikings, and he starts learning their language just by listening to them. And then one day he starts speaking back to them and they're all very surprised and like, how did you learn our language? And he said, I listened to you. And so he starts talking with them. And it's a really interesting just language learning example from a movie. But when I was able to communicate on his level like that as a fluent speaker, and even I'm only saying one thing, I didn't have a long conversation with the guy, but just that one thing was enough. So you don't need to know the whole language, but you should be confident about the things that you know. And you can do that very quickly. So that was just my kind of long story about that. But but definitely watch The 13th Warrior. I think you can probably find a clip on YouTube about that. But just like for language learning, it's an interesting way of showing somebody learning a language like that. So it took me, once I started learning English or learning Japanese as a first language, I started to learn things very quickly. But then I just expanded what I was learning. And so even learning things like numbers like that, it became fast for me. All right, can you recommend any strategy to correct what's already learned using translation? Yes, you just learn new things in English. You're basically replacing the connection you have with the translation with the new thing in English. So if I learn a word in Japanese through my native language, I want to learn maybe a different way of expressing that through Japanese rather than learning it through English. Let's see, Q Naro, let's see, feel free to leave as you are free to go, equals get out of here. Well, feel free means like I'm allowing you to do something. Get out of here is I'm being, it's not the same thing. So be careful with that. So being if I'm telling someone, hey, get out of here, I'm angry with them or I'm yelling at them, get out of here, you know. Or I could be like telling my kids like, all right, get out of here. You know, you guys can go play, something like that. So my mood, my tone of voice is important for that. But no, they are not the same thing. All right. Or how to quit using translation forever. Yes. Again, like the point is just to switch instead of learning. It's like you can learn something through English or through your native language and then try to learn English that way, or you can just go directly to the English. So which would you rather do? Do you want to go through a translation and then to English, or do you want to just go directly to English? Now, maybe as a young kid, you played a game called Telephone. I think some people call it Chinese Whispers, but it's basically a game where you have a line of kids like this, and they say something to the next person. So the first person says something and then maybe people don't hear it very well. And at the end, it's not quite clear. It might even be like a completely different thing because people couldn't hear it well or something like that. So the more steps you have when you're thinking, that makes it more difficult for you to express yourself. So if you want to go directly to the language, that's the most efficient way to learn. That's the fastest way to get fluent and actually understand things so you feel confident about using them. let's see. All right, Eamon says, what is the key to speak English fluently? I'm tired of learning. Yep, it's just to understand it like a native speaker. So instead of you being tired of learning, it means you are frustrated and bored and tired because you were thinking too much as you learn. And you're thinking too much because you're probably doing this. So you're studying more things, you don't really understand them, you're not getting real examples, but it's probably not frustrating to watch this video with me because I'm doing all the work. I'm the one making it easy to understand. And so that's why a good teacher is very important for learning. And for me, like I don't really have a teacher for learning Japanese. I have to do that by myself. So it takes me more time, but I can make it very fast and easy for my learners because I'm doing all the work. All right, the trickiest thing, Cooper, is that English learners aren't able to use continuous tense appropriately and contextually. Native speakers use it immensely. But you can get used to anything in the language. There's nothing particularly tricky about that. And as I explained for people learning different languages, if you go to different countries and watch little kids learn languages, they all learn at basically the same rate. So I don't go to, I don't know, Turkey and watch like Turkish kids. They don't get fluent until they're like 20 years old or something. They all get fluent around the same rate. And that's because they're all learning as a first language. That's really how they're doing it. Aka says, teacher, why do some people use was with you and don't with he, she? I have seen in some movies. I need an example sentence of that. I don't know what you mean exactly. Hi there. Hi, good job from Azils as a Magno. Your tonality is too distinct. My tonality is too distinct. I don't know what that means. All right, let's see. Is watching videos with English subtitles a good strategy? Anything that helps you understand what you're learning, but it should be subtitles in English to make the language clear. Or more complicated content like movies and shows. You should watch something that's at your level. So if you don't really understand something, then go back to something easier. Like me, I still enjoy watching Japanese children's TV shows because I learn a lot, and it's I don't need to be watching like a government program or the news or something like that. I can learn a lot about everyday communication the same way kids do. What about to learn to write English? Yeah, it's the same thing. You should just get lots of examples of that. All right, psychotic again is back. Do you think you can lose your accent by simply listening to natives talk, or do you need an accent reduction program? Well, I think like you would listen to that. You would listen to lots of different examples of that just to hear that, but you would find your own voice from doing that. And so you would, the goal is to speak. And so using what you learn, I think you would do that naturally. So the accent reduction program is actually just listening to lots of other people speaking. And then you might try to copy what they say. That's an easy thing to do as well. Diana says, you are an amazing teacher. Well, you are so kind. Thank you very much. Call all your friends. Say, watch this show. Come watch Drew. Also, click the like button if you have not done that already. Miro says, I guess even the environment influences, like if I'm not using what I'm learning in daily life, it's kind of harder to learn. Yeah, sure. Yeah, you could say that. I mean, at the most basic part, it's just, are you learning it as a first language or are you learning it as a second language? And everything else above that, like how often you use something, whatever, that's important. But the most important thing, the fundamental thing for language learning is, are you learning it as a first language or a second language? Zakiyama says, thanks always. Are you confident in mastering another language other than English and Japanese, like Chinese, by using your learning method? And do you have a plan to start learning another language? I think if I had a teacher who could teach me the way I teach English, then I would do that. But at the moment, I'm more interested in just helping people learn my language rather than, it's just not very interesting to me to learn a bunch of other languages for myself. Only if maybe that helped other people do it. I think it would be a little bit easier to learn some Chinese just because I could read some of the characters and some of the characters have the same meaning. But it's a different spoken language completely from Japanese. Elder, howdy, Drew. Listen to you as usual and improve my English day by day. Thanks, Noam. It's my pleasure. Paul says, great accent and great advices. Now, remember, be careful. It's great advice. So advice is uncountable. So I have great markers, but I can't have great advices. You can have pieces of advice, though, if you want to count that. Follow you years ago. Thanks. My pleasure. Miro again. Like I speak at home with my family, probably in my first language, studying in French and speaking with my colleagues in another language. It's so complicated, though. I put so much time listening to English. Yeah, again, depending on how you learn. So if you're learning and it's difficult to understand and you're not having fun because you don't really understand very well, then that will make it more difficult for you to learn. But if you're getting English lessons, like English as a first language lessons, like what I'm doing here, then it should be easier and you should be able to develop fluency in that. Injured is back. Oh no, you should be all healed by now. You're still injured. Oh my goodness. Hi, Drew. How are you? Indeed, I'm interesting to join your program. Now here you would say, I'm interested in joining your program, but I need more details about it in terms of the learning method. All right, so basically, as I showed a little bit ago, the way Fluent for Life works is that we're going to teach you English as a first language, but we basically need to retrain you to stop thinking through your native language, and that's just a process that we use basically a bunch of steps to get you to do that. So we take a real conversation, but if you just watch the conversation directly, so it's a conversation between native speakers, it's like watching a movie. It's going to be difficult for you, might be overwhelming with the fast speech and the difficult accents. Maybe some of it is hard to understand. So instead of starting with the conversation, we start you with some simple lessons that help you understand some of the grammar, some of the vocabulary, and work you up in steps to understanding that. So if you can understand me in this video, This is a really different language than the way natives normally speak. So it's different from the way I would normally speak English with friends of mine as well. But you get to see that in the conversation. So me speaking with friends and family, using idioms and slang and phrasal verbs and all that. But we don't teach it to you all at once because you wouldn't really remember anything. And it would just be difficult for you. But we teach it to you in pieces, and each of those pieces you learn that as a native. So if I'm going to teach you grammar, for example, I'm trying to show you how something works. That's why I use video. So if I'm going to take off the cap, so I take off, just like I could take off my shirt, I could take off my glasses. So I'm trying to teach you as a first language, take you through specific steps that get you fluent. You review things in different ways to make sure you understand them. Honestly, I wish I had like a very simple way to explain the program, but it's really just teaching you English as a first language in simple steps. And that way we take you from where you are to where you want to be. That's really the whole program. So if you'd like to learn more, just click on the link in the description below this video. And if you have specific questions, like there's anything you don't understand, you can ask me right now, or you can send us an email at info@englishanyone.com. Let's see. All right, Mamdou, why do I speak English more fluently when I speak to native speakers, and I feel that I am doing a much better job communicating in English than when I speak to non-natives or people who don't speak English? This is a psychological issue, I think, that just affects people where they're more competitive. Maybe you probably experience something like this. If I'm at a party and it's all Japanese people there, even if I speak Japanese perfectly or not, I mean, the most Japanese people, I think maybe really 100%, they're not going to laugh at me really, or, you know, I mean, they might laugh if I do something funny, but I'm under no pressure to be a fluent speaker because they don't think I can speak fluently. So I'm not really worried about anything in that way. But if you put another foreigner there, then suddenly we're kind of competing with each other. And so they, like, that's where you will find people get a little bit more worried about how they speak. So if I think I'm a good speaker and then I meet like another foreigner who's like a much better speaker, then it's like, oh no, like that guy can speak really well. And I think, like, I don't really worry about that issue. Like, I just speak at the level I speak at and I continue to improve, and I'm just focusing on my own thing. But I've had lots of people like ask me about this specific problem, and I think that's the reason for it. So again, when you're speaking to native speakers, they have maybe less, you feel less worry about like competing with someone else on that. And you might not be thinking about it consciously, but that could be a reason why, I would guess. You might be a naturally born hustler. I suppose, maybe. I don't know. I don't do much like hustling, really. I just, you know, hustling is a lot of work. Mamadou, again, I have two colleagues. One of them is a native and the other is not. When I speak to the native one, I feel like I'm talking more confidently and even my pronunciation is better. However, when I speak to the non-native colleague, where you seem to disappear. Yeah, so I'm guessing like that's a psychological issue then. It's not about the language itself. All right. Here in Germany, it's called silent male. Ahmed says, I pronounce correctly. I learned the phonics, but I still don't sound like a native speaker. So why? Without hearing you actually speak, that would be difficult to answer. But for most people, learning the phonics is one step of that process. And then the next is just getting lots of examples of how natives really speak. So phonics will help you understand the way individual words are pronounced. But in real conversations, words are often pronounced differently. And so you have to learn, if you want to sound like a native speaker, you need to look at the whole picture. It's not just looking at individual words like that. So that's why, like, Frederick is a part of what we do. And a lot of people who join programs like the Native Fluency Blueprint or Fluent for Life, they will get Frederick as well. So they're learning the individual words and sounds, and also hearing how everything blends together from native speech. 13 Words, a film which Omar El Sharif was acting in. Yeah. Can you say the synonym or a synonym of the word tricky. It would depend on the situation what the synonym would be. So if something is tricky like difficult, that's a synonym for that, but something could also be tricky like mischievous, that kind of thing. So it depends on the specific meaning for the situation. Remember that words don't really mean anything by themselves. It's only in a particular situation that words get meaning. Just like the example of the word, I think last week's video we talked about this, like the word trunk. So it could be an elephant trunk. It could be like a suitcase that you take to different places. It could be the trunk of a tree, the trunk of your body. So it just depends on the particular situation. says, I have a question. So you'd say, I have a question from Lombok. What is the difference between used to and used for? I answered that in a video, like, what video is that? It's like 2 or 3 weeks ago, I think. Look for that. But I think I specifically did that example. I think actually, if you go to the channel and look for... Yes, go. There's a specific, I think I cut a section of a video as a short and made that available. Go to the channel and find that. So just our YouTube channel. Yogi from Sumbawa here. Do you think idiom is important? Well, again, like idioms are, you know, it's just a way of communicating like anything else. And so phrasal verbs are important, or idioms or proverbs or other things like that. It just depends on how you speak. A lot of people may not use idioms, but it's important to be prepared for them because you will hear idioms from other people. All right, I'm following you from Haiti. You are great. Glad to hear it, says Samuel. Here again, thank you, XDL. When it relates to Kanye, everybody gonna be wondering who's in Paris. Uh-oh. Well, I don't really know anything about Kanye West, but let's see. I'm currently in Japan. Do you do offline teaching program? No, I do not. But yeah, I mean, it's the reason I don't offer private lessons. I don't even teach people privately in person over here. Like, people have asked me to teach them, but I don't. And the reason I don't is, number one, it would be like really expensive because it would take up my personal time. But number two, you really don't want to learn with a personal teacher. So it would probably be more stuff like this, when what you really need is, you need some of that, but you need a lot more of examples from native speakers actually communicating. And so that's why we created Fluent for Life, because you really need a program to give you all of those different examples to simulate the real language environment that you would be learning if you were a native speaker. So if we want to teach you English as a first language, I'm only one piece of that. The rest of it is hearing lots of examples from other natives to make sure you're understanding what they sound like. Can you give examples how to use strengthen out? Do you mean straighten out? Like take something? Like if I have a little string or something like that and pull it, do you mean straighten out? Is that what you mean? But that's just to make something straight. Sam says, kids shows for learning any language in the world make it easier because they are so clear. Yes. So also, like, those people on kids shows are trying to be clear so little kids can understand what they're saying. How to memorize vocabulary. I have a program about that. You can find that on my channel as well. But it's called How to Remember Any English Word. That's also included in Fluent for Life. But look on the channel. I already answered that. Amber says, do you have a distinguished tone and simple way to deliver the information when you are talking in English? I can understand what you say, although I can't understand other Americans when they're talking. Yes. So again, as I showed before, I'm speaking a different language than how natives normally speak. So natives and me right now in this video, I'm speaking differently than how I would normally speak. But we built Fluent for Life to get you from where I'm speaking now to where natives are speaking. Saiva says, is grammar matter in spoken English? Yes, so grammar matters in everything. Grammar is really the most important part, because if you don't speak correctly, or if you change the order of words or change other things in a sentence, then you change the meaning of the sentence. And the psychotic is back. I teach English as a first language in Egypt, but some students respond to me in Arabic because they know I speak Arabic too. Should I just ignore their responses in Arabic and keep with English? Yeah, I would try to get them to do that. But really, really try to encourage them to speak and make sure you are being clear and easy enough for them that they feel confident talking in English. But I promise you, when they start to communicate in English back to you, it's because they feel very confident. You did a good job of explaining something, and that will, again, that will make them feel confident about speaking. So you don't have to worry about that. Like I don't do anything about trying to make people more entertained or whatever in the lessons. It's just, do they understand the information or not? It's like a puzzle. You feel good when you solve it. And if you don't solve the puzzle, you feel frustrated and annoyed by that. Dayton, hey, Arturo here, how are you? Oh, I guess you're talking to each other. Only speed, I'm from KSA and I have problems with speaking, even though I have learned many vocabulary. Yes, so this is the core problem that we solve with Fluent for Life. So it's for people who know a lot of English, but still can't communicate fluently. The problem, the reason that people have these problems is because they learned English as a second language. So you're learning it through your native language. You're learning mostly vocabulary lists and grammar rules and studying the language rather than really understanding it as a first language the same way natives do. So if you can switch, if you stop learning English as a second language, you start learning English as a first language, then you start speaking. That's how I use it. All right, I'd love to meet you in person in Japan to expand my foreign friends community. Is it possible? Arigato gozaimasu. Well, depending on where you live, I don't know. We'll see. Regan says, Pat, I had the same situation as you. And I always keep saying or responding by English, but I thought, oh, okay, you're talking to him. All right, do native speakers speak differently with non-natives? Yes, we call this code switching. And so natives, if they think someone is not a fluent speaker, then they will change the way they speak and they will try to speak more like simply and more slowly and more clearly. So if they're trying to be helpful like that, some people don't care and they will not change the way they speak anyway. Hello from Laos, is today your birthday? No, it was last Thursday, but thank you. So how to use straighten out correctly. Again, if I take something, like if I have a bag, it's crumpled up like this. I want to straighten it out like this. So here it is, it's crumpled up or bent. Now I'm going to straighten out. And so I can take this is a physical idea to straighten something out, like I'm straightening out my hair. But I could also use that figuratively or metaphorically and say I'm straightening out a problem. So I could think about, oh no, there's like some confusion or a problem in my life in the same way. I need to straighten that out. Straighten that out. So we need to straighten out a person. Maybe a person is not behaving well. We need to straighten them out too. All right, hopefully that makes sense. All right, I think Samuel again, how can I improve my speaking if I get none to speak? The way you improve your speaking is to understand what you're trying to say. So if you have people to speak with, like, and this is an interesting problem because lots of learners do have someone to speak with. They might even speak every day, but they still don't feel fluent. And that's because they're still trying to think and translate in their heads when they speak. So it doesn't matter if you have someone there to speak with or not. If you don't understand what you're saying, that's where the real problem is happening. So think about it like this. I need to straighten out this board over here. It's getting a little messy. So for people learning English as a second language, usually what they think is like, I'm going to learn something. So there's like, I'm studying something, learning something, and now I'm going to try speaking that thing. But then they don't actually feel fluent. And so the fluency, like there should be fluency here, but it doesn't come. But for English as a first language, really what we're trying to do is like spend a lot of time learning until we get to like strong understanding of whatever that content is. So I really need to understand that thing well. I need to know it, and then I feel confident about using it, and that's when I speak. So then I speak after that. And so really, like, the fluency is actually developed here. So fluency is not, it's not a result of speaking. fluency is a result of understanding, and then there's just maybe a little bit of practice that comes from that. Maybe you need to work on saying something if you have a particular word that's more difficult to say. But to move from understanding something to feeling confident about it, this is really where the fluency is developing. So fluency is not a result of speaking, it's a result of understanding the language well. Because if you don't understand well, how can you speak? So I can try to say things, but it's really going to use a lot of mental power to do that, because I'm trying to, as a learner of a second language, I'm thinking a lot and translating in my head, and it's becoming more difficult to communicate. But if I'm doing it through English and I understand something, then I feel confident about using it. It's just like me learning Japanese. When I started learning Japanese, I was learning Japanese as a second language. And that's why it was difficult. I would learn something, try to say it, but I never really felt confident about what I was saying. So I never became fluent. But when I started learning Japanese as a first language, I spend some time learning until I really understand something well. And I get that aha moment of like, ah, now I understand what that means. So that's really where the fluency is developing. So it's not because you practiced speaking, it's because you understood something well. Okay? So this is where the real practice that happens here, it just means you're getting lots of examples of something or some good examples until you understand something very well. So when you understand, you feel confident, and then you speak. All right? So, of course, if you don't have anyone in your life to speak with, you're not speaking in either example anyway. But you can learn by yourself like this. And that way, when you learn by yourself like this, you feel confident. And when you are in a situation, the words just come out naturally because you're fluent already. So the fluency is the understanding of the language rather than after you're practicing something over and over and over again. All right. I've talked in, there's another recent video also about repetition and why repetition doesn't really help you learn. It can help you a little bit, but it's less helpful than naturally varied review. And I talk about that at length. So I explain a lot about that in that video. But there, again, the point is that I'm getting lots of examples until I understand something rather than trying to just repeat something again and again. So I don't get fluent in vocabulary just by repeating it. I get fluent by understanding what I'm saying, the same way a native does. All right? It looks like the chat kind of dried up. Either people are just listening to what I'm saying, or this makes sense over here. Does this make sense? Is everybody getting this? Am I being clear? Did I straighten this out? So don't worry about finding someone to speak with, because finding someone to speak with doesn't really affect your ability to get fluent. It's just, can you get lessons that help you understand the language like a native, and that makes you feel confident about speaking? Okay? All right, people are listening. I'm just making sense. Okay, it's nice to get feedback from people, but if people understand what I'm saying, that's great. So Naruto or One Piece, who's more attractive in Japan? You mean like the characters, how they physically look? I don't really know much about those. I know of them, but I don't know. I don't know. I don't care about One Piece or Naruto or any of that. All right, it's my 14th year studying English. Congratulations, only speed. Look at that, you got the Pepe frog. Nice. Little berries along the path, nice to see you again. It's a timeless principle you're teaching. Yes, again, I didn't create anything new. I didn't invent any like fantastic method. All I'm doing is taking what you do for your native language and applying that to English. So you have already been learning your own language as a first language. Now, just do that with English. And the best reason to do that is because ESL lessons are not working. That's the reason you're watching this video now. If you were already fluent, you would probably not be watching this unless you just like listening to the sound of my voice or something like that. So that's the secret. Stop learning English as a second language. Learn as a first language, and very quickly, everything starts to change for you in the way you communicate. Your confidence goes up. Everything improves. All right, understanding is the first step for fluent speaking. Got it. Yes. Again, if you don't understand something, how can you speak? It's like even if I'm a native English speaker, if I have to give a speech about fixing cars, and I don't know anything about fixing cars. I can't, how am I going to give a speech about that? I can't talk confidently about fixing cars if I don't know anything about fixing cars. Okay. Let's see. Anonymous, does accent matter because everybody got an accent in the U.S.? So what accent should we pick? Yeah, accent is less important than just speaking correctly and finding the right English-speaking voice for you. So people will speak differently, and you will probably develop an accent from the people you spend time with. So like me, I spend a lot of time with my, well, not a lot of time, but I spend time with my mother-in-law. And so like I will talk sometimes like an old Japanese woman, you know, just because I'm listening to her. But this is also the reason why if you're learning English as a second language, often people will have, there's the teacher and then there's the student down here. And so you will get a lot of influence from one person. But when you learn English as a first language, you have many teachers. So they're all teaching you, and that's how you develop your accent and be able to understand natives and all those things. Let's see. Okay. Akash says, if I replace words with phrasal verbs and learn some situational idioms and fixed phrases, I'm going to sound like a native. Yes, you will sound more like a native, but like the best way to sound native is just to communicate fluently and not like... Natives will know, just like me, I know when I'm speaking with someone, if they don't speak well, but then they use an idiom or something, it just sounds unnatural. So the idioms and phrasal verbs and all of that stuff, that should fit naturally into your way of speaking. So if you speak incorrect grammar, like if your basic grammar is incorrect, but then you use some more interesting phrase, it will sound weird. All right, so you want to make sure you speak correctly and then start adding those other things in. And so this is why, like young children, they're learning the same way. They will begin, like my younger daughter, or both of them, like they will learn a basic way to express something, and then they will learn other ways as they get older. So they start with something basic, and here's like intermediate and more advanced. So those are all correct. They might say like, hello, how are you? So they learn something simple like, hello, like say hello. But then we teach them like, how's it going and what's up and other things like that. And so for this situation of greeting people, there are lots of different ways to do that. But children learn to do this in steps. They don't just jump to like to difficult vocabulary. They're not trying to use idioms and phrasal verbs just to be using them. So you will sound native if you speak correctly and if you're appropriate for your speech. So eating lunch and watching, so relaxing. Yes, I need to eat lunch too. Where are you right now? You must be like around, like, because in Japan it's only like 11:20. You must be like out in the ocean or something already eating. Tell me about your daily activities, sir. Tell me what is interesting about your country. Something interesting about Japan? What's something interesting about Japan? Something interesting about Japan. I think I talked about this before. I'll mention it again. But I have an idea. I thought about doing like some videos about this on the YouTube channel, but like a lot of people don't care about Japan. It's not, you know, for my channel, it's not the focus of what I do. But here's an interesting thing that I find about Japan. I think I talked about this, and this is like the magic button. What I call the magic button on like computer screens. So if I go to a like order a ticket or something from a train, like I'm at the train station, I'm gonna get a ticket for a train. And if I go to a person, there's a person sitting there doing that. Like if I wanted to get bullet train tickets, the person will tap. There's usually little buttons on a touch screen that they tap. But they also tap off the screen like on a different part of the monitor that doesn't actually do anything. And so I just thought it was just an interesting thing about their training. They're like, they're basically tapping like this, like tapping pretty quickly. And they keep tapping this magic button up here. And I asked a lady one time, I said, what is that? What is this extra button that you're tapping over? And she like couldn't think, because it didn't actually have a reason, but they're probably, you know, trained to do something like that. And so instead of not pressing anything, they tap on this little magic button over here. So there are little things like that that you notice about the country after you've been here for a while. But yeah, as far as like things I do every day, I'm, you know, I do a little bit of work, I do some reading, do lots of reading actually. Talking to people, just walking around, you know, and then I walk home and have some dinner with the family. What is the best way to learn easier, more vocabulary, asks Samuel. You just learn it like a native speaker. You find a particular topic and you focus on that and get lots of information about that topic. And all of that information will help you understand it much better, build a native vocabulary that you will feel confident about using. So that's why we teach it. It's like we do all the things I recommend. That's what we do in Fluent for Life. Emmer says, do you speak another language except English and Japanese? No, I don't. I can kind of pretend like I speak Chinese, but no, I don't. Let's see, Dozo. Oh, that's some, maybe, I don't know, some Chinese or something. Do you find it hard to understand people who are speaking English from all? Yeah, so there are like people that have accents that are more difficult, but I've spent many years teaching people who speak different. Like they come from different places and speak English, so I'm pretty used to it. Praise Lord, slang and idiomatic expressions, it's a bit difficult to learn. Say hello to Brazil. Hello from Brazil. Shanghai, okay. Drew, may you put down Fluent for Life in 3 or 4 deposit? It's better if you just save your money. So save your money each month and then join the program when you can. It's just easier for us to process payments that way. How Americans say a bottle of water, it's the difference in English, like a bobo, like. Yes, and even in England, there will be like different ways of saying that, so they will have different accents. Like a bottle of water. And so in American English, we pronounce the whole thing like bottle of water, but they say like water. A bottle of water. But that's kind of like Americans making fun of British English. From Tokyo. You're from Tokyo? Where are you? Are you Japanese? Where are you from? Or where are you from? Do ninjas exist in Japan? Probably. You know, I have seen there. I went with my family a few months ago to a ninja movie studio where they make movies, and so you could have like a ninja show and stuff like that. It was pretty entertaining. Do you have a method to keep conversation not becoming awkward? Yeah, watch other videos on our channel about that, like how to keep speaking. But the foundation of everything is learning English as a first language. That's really the secret. And then trying to, like, I think there's another video of mine getting popular again recently, which is like how to keep speaking in English. So watch that video. Teacher, I was wondering how Americans sound when they try a British accent. Can you please do a British accent? So again, there are different kinds of British accents. So I did the kind of bad, like a kind of Cockney accent, I guess. There are people who do that much better than I do. But that's when we were kind of making fun of that accent, like water, you know. A bottle of water, isn't it? Yeah. And it sounds funny to us, but, you know, and there are people who actually speak like that. Like, who is that? Like a Sasha Cohen who does Borat and Ali G. Watch Ali G. So Ali G. Ali, I'm not writing that clearly. A-L-I-N-G. So that's a guy who, like, his regular speaking voice is just a regular kind of, I don't know, upper class British, I guess you would say, but he pretends to speak that way. So he's speaking like that. Isn't it? Is this nice weather, isn't it? You know? But I'm not great with the British accent. I'm Japanese and I've been learning English for 13 years. Just need more friends who speak English as a first language. Yeah, and there, you don't need anyone in Nagasaki then. I'm sure you can find people in Tokyo. All right, can you pronounce my name as Nero? Is that what that is? Nero? Nero K? Nero K isn't silent
in this case, by the way, I changed my car's motor oil a couple days ago. I can teach you if you're interested. Yeah, again, like I don't care about you. I don't have a car. So I've got trains and I can get around and I can use a car if I need one. But yeah, I just like knowing more about cars, it would be nice to know, I guess. But that's just not a big deal for me. Let's see how much time we have left. We're about to shut this down, but we'll answer, let's see, a few questions about that. What is the motive made you think learning Japanese? So when I was younger, I wanted to come to Japan to learn Japanese gardening. So that's what I did. But I enjoy teaching, and that's what I do. We got some, it's Portuguese. I'm probably not going to pronounce that. Is it like, voce e um grande professor? Professor, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Means you're a great teacher in Portuguese. Well, thank you very much. Yeah, I can like understand some of that because we have some of the Latin roots, same roots, like in Spanish. So we got, I remember I did like construction work when I was younger and I was working with some Mexican guys and we would listen to Mexican radio and I would talk with them. But a lot of the words are the same. Pronunciation is just different. We used to listen to this show called Que Buena, and I would love to say that. I would like talk to the Mexican guys, and I would always be excited when that show came on. Que Buena. So, is there an offer for the program? Well, click on the link in the description below the video if you'd like to learn more about it. Alex says, I love your hairstyle. Oh, well, that's nice. Thank you very much. Yeah, I'm doing what I can with what I have. So as I lose my hair, I want to like shave it all off, but my wife won't let me. She would think, no, it's too early. Not yet. And I think Nils also said I can't cut it either. I found myself get trouble to pronounce can and can't in American accent because they drop the T. Help me, please. Yes. And so that's again where you need to hear lots of different examples. But we do that. These are the things we do in Fluent for Life. Your eyes got tired already, Drew. Feel free to go. Yes. So I'm like, let me get a drink over here too. My voice. I got up early today. I was up today at like 4 in the morning, 4:30 or something. But yes, I'll shut it down in a moment. All right, Nasir says, hello, sir. Can you please tell me the specific sound name produced by flippers when walking with that pair? Like the onomatopoeia or whatever? It would probably be like flip-flop, I guess, if you wanted to talk about how it would sound. Good example, you can go, you can't go from different songs. Yep. Gash says, why did you leave Hollywood and become a teacher? I've seen you in Forrest Gump. Yes. People do think I look like Tom Hanks, but it's only non-native speakers that say that. Nobody in America thinks I look like Tom Hanks. And this is, again, those subtle differences. I actually made a video about that. I made a video about, like, Tom Hanks teaches you English. You should watch that video. Thank you for your efforts, says Angel. And I think we just finished the chat. We've got 100 minutes. Oh, my goodness, going for 100 minutes over here. But I think that's a good time to finish. But if you would like to learn more, you can do these things by yourself. It's just difficult to do and to make sure you understand everything and get enough examples. It is possible. But if you'd like it much more like easily done, that's what we do in Fluent for Life. And if you'd like to join the program, you are way handsome than him. He's also like 80 years old or something, or like 70 years old, you know? What does any more mean? Google that. Don't ask me for just definitions and stuff. You watch the movie, let's see. You watch the movie, A Man Called Otto. A Man Called Otto. Anonymous says, thank you. Thanks for your program. Good program. Please keep on. Why do you pronounce the word two like do sound? And again, that's just part of how we pronounce things. So in a regular conversation, then we would be saying like, duh. And that's why you learn, when you learn English as a first language, you understand that vocabulary can change, so the meaning can change, the pronunciation can change in a particular situation. So if you're talking about one thing, like I'm going to the park, or I'm going what are you gonna do after work? Like I'm going to, just to make like the clear pronunciation. But like, what do you wanna do? What do you wanna do? What do you wanna do? So what do you want to do, we wouldn't say that. We just pronounce it more quickly. What do you want to do? What do you want to do? Want to do. All right. So again, keep learning English like a first or as a first language. If you'd like to learn more, you can click on the description links below this video. So both for Frederick and for Fluent for Life. And I'll see you in the next video. Bye-bye.